Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, I report on fossils discovered from a massive ancient snake. Andrew Smith has a story on Earth Day. Bryan Lynn brings us the science report on NASA looking for faster, less costly ways to transport Martian rock samples to Earth. Later, Andrew and Jill Robbins present the lesson of the day. But first, an ancient giant snake in India may have been longer than a school bus and weighed up to a metric ton, researchers reported Thursday. Ancient remains of the snake were found near a coal mine in the western state of Gujarat. Researchers say it stretched an estimated 11 meters to 15 meters. It is comparable to the largest known snake at about 13 meters. That snake existed in what is now Colombia. The largest living snake is Asia's reticulated python at 10 meters. The newly discovered snake lived 47 million years ago in western India's damp evergreen forests. It could have weighed up to 1,000 kilograms, researchers said in the journal Scientific Reports. The researchers gave it the name Vasuki indicus. It is named after the mythical snake King Vasuki, who wraps around the neck of the Hindu deity Shiva, said study co-writer Debajit Datta of the Indian Institute of Technology Roorkee. The ancient snake was too big for quick attacks. Considering its large size, Vasuki was a slow-moving ambush, Datta said. In hunting for food, the snake would wrap its body around a target in a crushing hold. Parts of the snake's backbone were discovered in 2005 by study co-writer Sunil Bajpai, who is based at the same institute as Datta. The researchers compared more than 20 fossil backbones to skeletons of living snakes to estimate size. It is not clear exactly what Vasuki ate, but other fossils found nearby suggest the snake lived in swampy areas alongside catfish, turtles, crocodiles, and early whales. These animals may have served as food for Vasuki. The other extinct giant snake, Titanoboa, was discovered in Colombia. It is estimated to have lived around 60 million years ago. Both snakes lived during exceptionally warm climate periods, said Cambridge University fossil scientist Jason Heed, who was not involved in the study. Snakes are cold-blooded animals, he noted. They require higher temperatures to grow large. So does that mean that global warming could bring back huge snakes? In theory, it is possible, Heed said. But it is not likely. The climate is now warming too quickly for snakes to evolve to such large sizes, the scientists said.
Earth Day celebrates its 54th anniversary on Monday, April 22nd. On this date each year, millions of people around the world mark the importance of protecting the environment. Worries about pollution and the environment began to increase in the 1960s. In 1962, American scientist Rachel Carson published her book, Silent Spring. It warned of the use of a chemical called DDT. The chemical kills insects, but also harms larger animals. The book became popular in the United States and other countries. As a result, more people became concerned about the environment. Gaylord Nelson, a U.S. senator from the state of Wisconsin, had the idea that would become Earth Day. Nelson saw damage from a large oil spill in the ocean near the state of California in January of 1969. At the same time, people at some universities were holding events called teach-ins to call for action against the war in Vietnam. Nelson's idea was to hold a national teach-in on the environment. Along with environmental activists, Nelson worked to expand the idea beyond universities. The activists wanted as many students as possible to take part. So they chose a weekday between spring break and final exams. On April 22, 1970, the first Earth Day took place. After the first Earth Day, the U.S. Congress approved more laws to protect the environment. In December of 1970, it added more rules to the Clean Air Act. And in 1972, it passed the Clean Water Act. Many consider Earth Day to be the beginning of the modern environmental movement. In 2000, the Earth Day organization started placing more attention on the warming of the Earth's atmosphere. This year, the event is centering on the harm that plastics can bring to the environment. Activists are calling for the end of single-use plastics. Earth Day is not an official holiday in the United States, but many groups use the day to put together volunteer events, such as cleanups of natural areas. At the website earthday.org, you can see a list of events around the world, or organize your own event. I'm Andrew Smith.
The American space agency, NASA, says it is seeking a faster, less costly plan to transport Martian rock samples to Earth. The search for a new plan comes after an independent review board offered its opinions on the agency's Mars sample return program. In addition, NASA has recently faced deep budget cuts that could affect the agency's many science missions. NASA Administrator Bill Nelson said that results of the independent review had persuaded the agency to reconsider the sample return effort. The goal is to seek ideas and advice from others on how to reduce mission costs and shorten the sample return date. NASA established the Independent Review Board in May 2023 to closely examine the Mars sample return program. The board estimated the total cost of the mission to be between $8 billion and $11 billion. The Martian samples would likely not arrive on Earth until 2040. NASA had estimated the total mission cost at $5 billion to $7 billion, with the sample return set for the early 2030s. The review board also said it found the sample return mission to be organized under an unwieldy structure. Unwieldy describes something that is difficult to deal with because it is large or complex. Recent budget issues at NASA led the agency to cut hundreds of jobs earlier this year at its Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, in California. NASA's Mars exploration teams operate at the JPL. NASA's Perseverance Explorer, or rover, has been collecting rock and soil samples around Mars's Jezero crater area since 2021. NASA officials have said it is important that the samples are brought to Earth for detailed study. Scientists say the samples could lead to new evidence about whether life existed on Mars. Perseverance has used its robotic equipment to collect 24 Martian samples so far. NASA's earlier plan called for the rover to gather 30 samples to be transported to Earth. The samples are kept inside secure titanium containers to protect them from the severe conditions on Mars. NASA had planned to pick up the materials by sending a spacecraft to Mars. But the spacecraft would then have to launch from the surface of Mars to join up with another orbiting spacecraft. That spacecraft would then bring them to Earth. The operation would be a joint mission between NASA and the European Space Agency, ESA. NASA Chief Nelson said the independent review's cost and target date estimates showed the agency should aim to do better. NASA has suggested it wants to bring at least some of the samples to Earth sometime in the 2030s for no more than $7 billion. The bottom line is an $11 billion budget is too expensive, and a 2040 return date is too far away, Nelson said. He added he has asked private industry experts and other groups within NASA to help come up with other possibilities. NASA's science mission chief, Nikki Fox, said the search for new solutions would center on innovation and proven technology, rather than on major new experimental proposals. Fox did not provide an estimated date for when the samples might arrive on Earth. She said that date, along with any information on the number of samples to be transported, will only be included in future mission proposals. "We've never launched from another planet, and that's actually what makes Mars sample return such a challenging and interesting mission," Fox said. Scientists want to closely examine the Mars material in their own laboratories in an effort to confirm any evidence of microscopic life dating back billions of years. Strong evidence has already demonstrated that water likely flowed freely in Mars's distant past. NASA officials have said the samples may also help the agency decide where to send astronauts in possible missions to Mars. Nelson expressed hope that the brightest minds at NASA, JPL, and private space companies would find the right solution. "These are folks who can figure out rather difficult things," he said. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his science report. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
Sure, Dan. Thanks for having me.
This week's report was about NASA reconsidering its plans for bringing rock samples collected on Mars to Earth. The report notes that 24 of these have so far been gathered. What exactly is contained in these samples?
Yes, NASA's Perseverance rover has been actively collecting these samples in an area called Jezero Crater since 2021, and with this effort, NASA engineers on the ground have been directing the rover to go to different areas to collect a variety of different kinds of materials. The rover also has a robotic arm it uses to drill down into the rocky Martian surface to collect many of these. And NASA has said these contain mostly a mixture of rock, sand, and minerals. And scientists will mainly be looking at these samples for what they call biosignatures. These are substances that could provide evidence of any past life on the planet.
Your report pointed out that wider budget issues at NASA had an effect on the agency's decision to reconsider its sample return plans. Are there other NASA projects that might be affected by budget problems?
So one program that has been identified for big cuts is NASA's Chandra X-ray Observatory. This is the agency's long-serving telescope using X-ray technology, which permits study of some distant and mysterious areas of our universe. And while the 2024 budget does not cut this program completely, it does call for reductions, and some scientists say these will eventually result in cancellation. Just last month, a group of concerned scientists appealed to top NASA officials in a letter to provide their best arguments for why they think Chandra is still cost-effective and should be saved.
All right. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
You're welcome. Thank you, Dan.
Is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
We talked about lesson 22 in our recent podcast. Today, we'll take a closer look at Lesson 23. Anna and her coworkers are going out for lunch together. They work in an area where there are not many restaurants, so people come with special trucks to the area at lunchtime.
Yes, we call these food trucks, and it's a fun way to explore different foods from all over the world. Washington, D.C. is an international city, so you can find foods from many cultures there. Since Anna came from a small town, she is not familiar with the food trucks in this lesson.
Washington, D.C. has great food from all over the world. Today, I'm having lunch with my boss. Ms. Weaver says we're going on a trip around the world, but she knows I only have an hour for lunch. Silly woman.
Hi, Anna.
Hi, Jonathan. Hey, we are meeting Ms. Weaver for lunch at noon, aren't we?
Yes.
What time is it now?
11:50.
11:50? We have to go. So, where is this world food restaurant?
We are not eating at a restaurant.
Where are we eating?
We are eating at food trucks.
I remember my first experience with food trucks. I was impressed that I could get Mexican food in a park. In other parts of the world, you might hear the term street food when people talk about buying food from a vendor, a seller, that is, who sets up a small table on the sidewalk or side of the street and cooks simple, delicious dishes for the people who are walking by.
Back to our story. Ms. Weaver wants to treat Anna and Jonathan to lunch. That means she is paying for the food. So she gives them each some money and tells them to find something to buy from one of the trucks. And of course, Anna thinks it's an awesome idea.
Food trucks? Awesome! What's a food truck?
These are food trucks.
Wow! Whoa.
Okay, Jonathan, you will buy the first dish. Here is $10. Surprise us.
Okay, I'll be back in 15 minutes.
What country do I want to visit?
Anna, you pick the second country. Here is $10.
I want chicken.
The food truck over there has great chicken.
Awesome!
After you buy your food, meet me here.
Do you enjoy eating at food trucks, Jill?
I used to when we worked downtown every day. Especially they had pho, the Vietnamese soup. It was so good. But now they don't come near the office. There are some near the museums, but they mostly sell ice cream and American food like hamburgers and fries. Besides, there's no place to sit near most of the food trucks.
Huh. That reminds me of what one of my cousins said. He said that food trucks would be nicer if they had some tables and chairs and refills on drinks.
But then they'd be restaurants. The other thing I don't like about food trucks is how noisy they are. They have to run a generator, a machine to make electricity for cooking and keeping the food warm or cold. It's already loud, and then they sometimes play loud music, too.
That's true, but you have to trade off the noise for the convenience of being able to buy your meal quickly and cheaply.
I don't know. They may be handy, but I still prefer a quiet restaurant or one with tables outside so you can enjoy nice weather. Then there's the problem of the trucks running out of food. In our lesson, both Jonathan and Anna have to change their orders because the food trucks have sold the meals they want.
Excuse me, I'll have the shrimp. Oh, you're out of shrimp? Okay, I'll have the beef then.
I want the chicken dish.
We're out of chicken.
You're out of chicken?
Yep.
I'll try another food truck. Thanks.
I noticed they said out of quickly, so it almost sounds like one word, out of. Jill, do you know any expressions with that pronunciation?
Yeah. When we leave a place, like when we're going home from our place of work, we might say, I'm out of here.
Notice that Jill used the word handy to talk about something that is convenient. And another thing that's convenient is how you can buy your food from a food truck with cash, a credit card, and now maybe with your phone. Let's hear how Jonathan returns part of the money Ms. Weaver gave him.
Okay, here's your change. The dish cost $7, so here is $3 back from your $10.
I noticed two things there. He says, here's your change, which means the money not needed for the cost of the food. And then he counts out the bills as he hands them to Ms. Weaver.
I think all of our listeners understand how we talk about our dollar bills, our paper money, but maybe it would be good to review what U.S. coins are.
Sure. There are four coins in regular use nowadays. Those are the penny, which is 1 cent, the nickel, 5 cents, and the quarter, which is 25 cents. people sometimes run into a half dollar, which is 50 cents, or a dollar coin, which is a dollar or 100 cents.
Jill, whose picture is on each coin?
Well, I'm not sure. Let me try. A penny is Abraham Lincoln, of course. On the nickel, it's Thomas Jefferson. Who's on the quarter now? Aren't there different ones for each state these days?
The backs of those coins are different now. There is one for each state. But the front is still our first president, George Washington. And here's a fun fact. In 2022, they made him face the opposite direction. He had always been facing to the left, but now he's facing to the right.
I'm not sure about the political meaning of that, but here's another fun fact about U.S. coins. One of my distant cousins was a model for the Walking Liberty half dollar. She was a neighbor of the artist.
That's a cool family story. Speaking of who is on the coins, we left out a very important historic figure. Do you remember who is on the dollar coin?
Since 2000, it's been Sacagawea, a Native American woman who guided Lewis and Clark across the West to the Pacific Ocean. I love those coins because they look like gold. At a family camp I used to go to, one of the men would always give the children a dollar coin to use for ice cream on the 4th of July.
Speaking of ice cream, in our lesson, it's time for dessert, something sweet to eat. Listen carefully to how Ms. Weaver asks Anna what she wants to do with the remaining money.
Well, we still have $8. What do you want now?
We can buy dessert.
I'll buy dessert.
In Washington, D.C., you can travel around the world with food trucks, and it does not cost a lot.
Ms. Weaver said, "What do you want?" instead of, "What do you want?" Isn't that pretty informal?
Yes, but remember, they are eating lunch on the street. It's a pretty informal situation.
Hey, Andrew, can we do another chant with what we learned today?
Sure. Yeah, let's do that. And listeners, you can practice some of the things we talked about today by repeating after us.
Food trucks, handy, noisy food trucks.
Get some lunch, get a snack, and then you will be right back.
What do you want?
I'll have fish.
Sorry, we're out of that. What do you want?
I'll have chicken.
Sorry, we're out of that. What do you want?
Okay, then I'll have shrimp.
You got it.
Food trucks. Travel the world with food trucks. Pay with cash or card.
You can even pay by phone, and it doesn't cost a lot. Now we have an assignment for you. We'd like to know your answer to our questions. Does your town have a special street food? How do you like to eat it? You can send your answer in an email to us on learningenglish@voanews.com. Or if you're watching this podcast on YouTube, put your answer in the comments. We'll read some of your answers in an upcoming podcast.
That's all for the lesson of the day today. You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins. Now I'm going to stop and get some ice cream at that food truck on the corner.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.